Now, where I want to focus there is in Revelation chapter number 2, verse number 25, where the Bible reads, we'll begin reading in verse number 24. But unto you I say, and unto the rest in Thyatira, as many as have not this doctrine, and which have not known the depths of Satan as they speak, he says this, I will put upon you none other burden. Verse number 25, but that which ye have already, hold fast till I come. So today is January 1st. It's the new year. And all the churches in America today, and all the churches that I've ever been to, on January 1st, so that first service in the new year, they always preach some sermon, some cute sermon about all the new things that you need to add to your life. And there's nothing wrong with that. Obviously, we should continually to strive to do better and strive to do more. And they're going to preach about all the things that you need to change this year. And they're going to preach about all the new things that you need to add to your spiritual walk with Jesus Christ. I'm going to preach the exact opposite. The title of my sermon this morning is Hold Fast in 2017. And I'm going to preach about all the things that you don't need to change and all the things that you need to keep the same in 2017 that you kept in 2016. So don't misunderstand me. I have my own New Year's resolutions too, things that I want to do better in 2017 than I did in 2016. I'm not saying that you shouldn't change anything. I'm not saying you shouldn't have any objectives or any goals to do better in 2017. But there are a lot of people that were serving God or in last year or the year before that, 2015, 2016. And when that new year came, something changed after a month or two. They were serving God. They were reading their Bible. They were going to church every week. And they did not only add things to what they were already doing, but they actually subtracted things. They stopped doing things that they should have kept doing. And that's what I'm going to preach about this morning. Go ahead and turn over one page to Revelation chapter number 3, verse number 11. We'll see this again. Revelation chapter number 3, verse number 11, when Jesus Christ is addressing one of the other churches. In Revelation chapter 3, verse number 11, he says, Behold, I come quickly, hold that fast which thou hast, that no man take thy crown. So there's that same exact statement. And in Revelation chapter number 2, at the end of verse number 24, he actually said, I will put upon you no other burden. None other burden is what he said. And he said, but that which ye already have, hold fast till I come. Turn to Philippians chapter number 3, verse number 1. So I believe, yes, you should have goals and you should have objectives for the new year and new things that you want to add and things that you should change. But you should also not lose sight and not stop thinking about the things that you're already doing. And you should make sure that you keep doing all the good things next year that you're doing this year. There's a lot of people that are going to fall out of church in 2017. I guarantee Faithful Word Baptist Church has a lot of members right now that attended almost maybe even the whole year in 2016. Which will stop going in 2017. So it's more important for that person to focus on keep doing the things that they were doing instead of adding new things. I'm not saying they shouldn't add new things. Like I said, don't misunderstand me. But where that person's focus should be is on holding fast what you already have. Just like Jesus Christ said that he put upon them none other burden. I'm not going to add anything else to you, but you should also hold fast that which you have. Look at Philippians chapter number 3, I'll read you first from 2 Peter chapter number 3, verse number 1. He says, This second epistle, beloved, I now write unto you. And then he says this, In both which I stir up your pure minds by way of remembrance. So he says, I stir up your pure minds by way of remembrance. He's saying this is the second epistle, obviously. It's 2 Peter chapter number 2. So 1 Peter chapter number 1, the book of 1 Peter was written to the same exact group of people. And when he wrote that second epistle, he says that he's writing this part, and what I'm getting ready to say is just to bring something to your remembrance. So oftentimes, we need to be reminded about things. We need the same subjects to be preached on to keep our minds set on those particular topics. In 2 Peter chapter number 3, verse number 17, at the very end of the book of 2 Peter, he says this, Ye therefore, beloved, seeing ye know these things before, so this is something that they already know, beware lest ye also, being led away with the error of the wicked, fall from your own steadfastness, but grow in grace and in the knowledge of our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ. To him be glory both now and forever. Amen. So he starts off that chapter saying, I wrote this to remind you about something. I wrote this to stir up your pure minds by way of remembrance. That's the purpose why I write. So we don't always need to add new things. And we don't always need to, you know, learn a new doctrine. Sometimes we need to hear the same things preached. And sometimes people don't like hearing the same things over and over again. Sometimes people get tired of hearing the same things. That's why Philippians chapter number 3, if you're there in Philippians chapter number 3, Paul words it this way. He says, "Finally, my brethren, rejoice in the Lord. To write the same things to you, to me indeed is not grievous, but for you it is safe." Why would he say, "For me indeed it is not grievous"? That's because sometimes it can be grievous to the person that's having to hear the same things over and over again. Like in 2 Timothy chapter number 4, the really famous passage, "Preach the word, be instant, in season, out of season." And then he tells them, you know, the different characteristics of preaching the word. I look at that passage in two different ways. When he says in season and out of season, you can stand up behind the pulpit and you can preach on a subject that people don't like because it offends them. But not only that, sometimes you can get tired of hearing the same type of preaching. Sometimes, you know, it's for the right reason. Sometimes the pastor's getting up behind the pulpit and he's preaching on the gospel every week and you want to be fed. But sometimes maybe the pastor's stirring up your pure mind by way of remembrance and it's something you need to hear. It's something you need to be reminded about. And then you kind of get it in your mind, well, I just know this subject. Don't have that type of attitude. Sometimes you need to be reminded about things. Sometimes you need to hear things over and over again, and you may personally feel like, hey, there's no way I'm going to stop going to church in 2017. There's no way I'm going to stop reading my Bible in 2017. You may even be as far as thinking, there's no way that I'm not going to do more for God in 2017 than I did in 2016. That's the type of attitude of the person that will fall out of church. The person that just takes it for granted. The person that's not holding fast that which they already had. And that's why hold fast, that's talking about holding it tight. Just like a minute ago when I read 2 Peter chapter number 3, he said, "Beware lest ye also, being led away with the error of the wicked, fall from your own steadfastness." So all the people that Peter wrote this epistle to, he felt it was necessary for him to warn them and to say, beware. Look at Philippians chapter number 3, look at the first word in verse number 2. Beware of dogs. So he's warning them. These are warnings that are given to people. Paul felt that it was necessary to repeat something to these people. 2 Peter thought that it was, in the epistle of 2 Peter, Peter felt that it was necessary to remind them or to warn them of something that they already knew. Now notice what it says too at the end of 2 Peter, "Being led away with the error of the wicked, fall from your own steadfastness." Now the word steadfastness, notice fast again. That's talking about something being fastened or something being tightened. Like we saw there in the beginning, the title of the sermon, hold fast in 2017. So yes, it's great to have new goals. Yes, it's great for you to say, hey, I want to do more for God in 2017. But you also can't forget about the things that you're doing today. You also can't just, you know, not have it in your mind at all about, you know, about continuing on where you're at. Or, you know, obviously it's good to grow. There's nothing wrong, like I said that many times now, there's nothing wrong with doing more in 2017. But make sure that you haven't lost sight of the things that you're already doing. Turn to 1 John chapter number 2. We'll see this again. 1 John chapter number 2. Later on in Philippians chapter number 3, he says in verse number 16, "Nevertheless, whereto we have already attained." So this is something they already knew or they have already done. He says, "Let us walk by the same rule." And then he says, "Let us mind the same thing." So the same thing that they had already attained to. Look at 1 John chapter number 2. Look at verse number 7. John says, "Brethren, I write no new commandment unto you, but an old commandment which ye had from the beginning." The old commandment is the word which ye have heard from the beginning. And then he says, "Again, a new commandment I write unto you." So notice, it's good to add something new. You should add something new. You should do more for God in 2017. But you also need to keep doing what you were doing in 2016. You also need to not lose sight and not completely forget about a lot of the things that you were doing in 2016. And an error that a lot of people make in their Christian life, when they're right there at the verge of just excelling, of being a great Christian, if maybe when they start soul winning in the very beginning, they're soul winning and they're doing awesome, and then they're like, they get really interested in soul winning, and then they start to forget about maybe prayer. And then that other area of their life is lacking. Or maybe it happens in the reverse order. Maybe they're like, hey, I need to really start focusing on praying. I'm doing soul winning. I need to start really focusing on my prayer life. Then they start praying more. And you know what happens sometimes? They forget about soul winning. Or they stop going to church. Or they neglect their Bible reading. So yes, we need to add things. We need to also always try to grow into that perfect Christian like the Bible talks about, which means complete. We need to strive to be that complete Christian. But we need to make sure that we don't forget about the things that we're already doing now. That we don't neglect or forget about stuff that we're doing today. We need to hold fast that which we have and then also add unto that. Look over at 2 John chapter number 1, just a few pages over. 2 John chapter number 1, we'll see this again. Look at verse number 5. And now I beseech thee, lady, not as though I write a new commandment unto thee, but that which ye had from the beginning, that we love one another. So over and over again, we see things being repeated over and over again. And the world that we live in today is a world that's given to change. It's a world that's constantly changing. We're taught that anything, if it's new, if something's being changed, then it automatically must be better. And that is not what the Bible teaches. Go to Galatians chapter number 1. So I'm going to preach to you about four things that you don't need to change, or four things that don't need to be new in 2017. Four things that you need to keep just the same as they are today, or four things that we don't need new in 2017. Go to Galatians, as I said, Galatians chapter number 1. Whoops. Galatians chapter number 1. Look at verse number 6. Galatians chapter number 1, verse number 6. The Bible reads, I marvel that ye are so soon removed from him that called you into the grace of Christ unto another gospel, which is not another, but there be some that trouble you and would pervert the gospel of Christ. But though we or an angel from heaven preach any other gospel unto you than that which we have preached unto you, let him be accursed. As we said before, so say I now again. If any man preach any other gospel unto you than that ye have received, let him be accursed. For do I now persuade men or God? Or do I seek to please men? For if I yet pleased men, I should not be the servant of Christ. And the very first thing that we don't need new is we don't need a new gospel. Now, all of these things are going to apply to a church as a whole, but to an individual person as well. Galatians chapter number 1 is written to saved Christians. So he's warning saved Christians about this, that if somebody tries to come into your church preaching a new gospel, and there are many, many churches out there, independent fundamental Baptist churches, that were preaching the right gospel in the past, they had a couple of new people come in and they started preaching a false gospel. They started preaching a repent of your sins type of gospel. And even saved Christians can get screwed up on this type of stuff, can get screwed up just a little bit. Obviously, they're never going to stop believing in the true gospel of Jesus Christ. That would never happen. But you know, the repent of your sins can infiltrate even saved believers. And they can just start repeating repent of your sins as jargon. You know, a really sad story that I heard about, I believe personally, a lot of people doubt this, I believe personally that there's no doubt that Ken Hovind is saved. He's been pinned down many times about, hey, what do you need to do for your salvation? And he'll say, you know, believe, and then maybe he adds something on there, and then somebody will question him, okay, well, do you have to do this or not? And then he's real clear. I believe it's only by believing. If a person believes and they continue in sin, they're still saved. Now, obviously, the guy's an adulterer. What he did was completely wrong, and I'm not defending that of his lifestyle. But we need to make sure that we're not just attacking every person that just says, you know, repent of your sins, as in they're not even saved. Because there are some people that get screwed up on this. Obviously, they need to be rebuked if they're going around and doing that, you know, and preaching that. But that is a false gospel, even if they're repeating it. And I believe there are people that are saved that do that. And I even heard something that's really sad and really ridiculous, is that a person that goes to our church today actually listened to Ken Hovind for like a year and they weren't even saved. And then they heard Pastor Anderson preach the gospel, and they heard Ken Hovind give the gospel scores of times. And they weren't even able to get saved on because they kept hearing repent of your sins. And they had already heard other people define repent of your sins as a change of lifestyle, as You know, a real false gospel, as in, you need to, you know, stop sinning. So when they heard Ken Hovind say that, they just assumed he meant the exact same thing. Because oftentimes these people that are saved, that just repeat repenting your sins is jargon. When you ask them what they mean, they're just like, I don't even know. Or you ask them what they mean and they'll give you an answer like, well, you just got to feel bad. They'll never say anything like, you know, you have to stop sinning. They obviously know salvation is not by works, and they won't, you know, pervert that aspect of the gospel. They're just adding this little thing to it that they don't even really understand what they mean. Sometimes they'll say, well, that just means admit you're a sinner. But they're repeating something that they don't understand or they don't know. And like I said, people like this need to be rebuked. And if that type of thing comes into the church, that's not something new that we need. We don't need a new gospel. People like that, they start bringing things up like that. Sometimes it is someone trying to infiltrate the church, and sometimes it is somebody trying to bring in a false gospel. But either way, a person like that needs to be, you know, called out, and they need to be rebuked. And that is not something new that we need. But this person, like I said, they got saved by Pastor Anderson's gospel. But they weren't even able to get saved by Ken Hovind giving the gospel because he kept saying, repent of your sins. Now, how sad is that? That a saved believer had the opportunity to get somebody saved, and then they're just repeating this jargon because they don't know what they're talking about. They're just repeating what other people are saying because, you know, they've just heard all these other popular preachers say, repent of your sins, and they just think that that's, you know, that's how they should say it, or whatever their reason, whatever their excuse. I can't even understand their reasoning or whatever their excuse may be. But that's pretty sad. I wonder how many people that he had the opportunity to get saved, and now these people are just so far gone. They're sucked into like a Church of Christ, or they're sucked into somebody else that preaches this same other trash or this same other garbage, and now they're not going to have the opportunity to hear the real gospel. Imagine what a shame and what an embarrassment people like Ken Hovind are going to be when they stand before Christ, and there's thousands of people that get thrown into hell, and God's like, hey, you had the opportunity to get these people saved. You had the opportunity to preach the right gospel, and you're repeating a bunch of idiots over here saying, repent of your sins. You know something new that we don't need in 2017 that we can keep from 2016 is the gospel. We don't need a new gospel. All these churches are changing what they believe constantly. They have some, you know, all these churches are so watered down nowadays. They'll have some pastor come in with a bunch of saved people in the congregation who believe the right gospel, and they'll have a pastor come in that's preaching repent of your sins, and everybody just allows it. And these are churches that aren't even set up with the right ecclesiastical structure. Churches where the pastor isn't even the authority, the deacons are there and they don't say a word. They don't say a word when it's, you know, this new thing that's being brought in. A new thing as in a false gospel. That's why he says, notice in this passage too, in Galatians chapter number 1, he says, I marvel that you're so soon removed from him that called you, watch this, into the grace of Christ unto another gospel. You know what that tells me? The other gospel is the opposite of the grace of Christ. That's because the Bible says, and if by grace, then is it no more of works. So that other gospel is going to be a gospel of works. And all these other gospels, all the other false gospels, yeah, there's a lot of differences in them, but they all have one thing in common. They're all a works-based salvation. They're all a works-based gospel. Look at the next verse. But though we are an angel from heaven, watch what he says. Preach any other gospel unto you. So what does that imply? That there's not only one other false gospel, he says any other, anything different than this, but that there's many. There's many. A lot of people say repent of your sins. A lot of people say that. But there are differences of these false gospels. The one thing they have in common is they're all false. And then number two things they have in common is that they're all works-based salvation. Church of Christ is very adamant on you must be baptized. Other people may say that's not a fact. You know, the Mormons say, you know, you have to be a Mormon. You know, all these other false denominations have many things about their, you know, they may have many differences about their false gospel that other false gospels don't have, but they do have all one thing in common from this passage. It's all a false gospel. It's all, you know, he warns you, it's the opposite. All of them are the opposite of the grace of Christ. They're all a works-based salvation. So one thing that we don't need new in 2017 is we do not need a new gospel. 2 Corinthians chapter number 11, verse number 4, it says, for if he that cometh preacheth another Jesus whom we have not received, or if ye receive another spirit which ye have not received, or another gospel which ye have not accepted, ye might you might well bear with him. You're going to have to bear with me because I'm going to keep coughing like this. Go to Acts chapter number 17. Acts chapter number 17. I'm like Ezekiel. In Ezekiel chapter number 2, he tells him, you're going to be dumb. You're going to be mute. You're not going to be allowed to speak for like a super long period of time except when I open your mouth. The only time I can speak is when I'm behind the pulpit. I'm able to preach, but that's it. Look at Acts chapter number 17. Acts chapter number 17, we'll begin reading verse number 16. Now while Paul waited for them at Athens, his spirit was stirred in him when he saw the city wholly given to idolatry. Therefore disputed he in the synagogue with the Jews and with the devout persons and in the market daily with them that met with him. Then certain philosophers of the Epicureans and of the Stoics encountered him and said, what will this babbler say? Other some, he seemeth to be a setter forth of strange gods, because he preached unto them Jesus and the resurrection. And they took him and brought him unto Areopagus, saying, may we know what this new doctrine whereof thou speakest is. For thou bringest certain strange things to our ears. We would know, therefore, what these things mean. Verse number 21, for all the Athenians and strangers which were there spent their time in nothing else but either to tell or to hear some new thing. So over and over again, it emphasizes that the Athenians, the Stoics, the Epicureans, they're very interested in something new. That they spent their time in to tell or to hear some new thing, it says. And then it records them speaking. And he says, for thou bringest certain strange things. When it says strange, he's saying foreign, something different. They're just dying to hear about something different. They're just so interested in hearing about something different. And then notice what they said in verse number 19. And they took him and brought him unto Areopagus, saying, may we know what this new doctrine whereof thou speakest is. And like I said, that's exactly what the world's like. They're just dying to hear something new. They're just dying to just receive anything new. And Christians are becoming the same exact way. And the second thing, the first thing that we don't need new, or the first thing that we don't need to change in 2017, sit down and stop now, is that we do not need a new gospel. Put your feet down. Number two, the second thing that we don't need new, or the second thing that we don't need to change, is we don't need new doctrine. Now, a lot of churches can't say that, because a lot of churches are so whacked out on so many different things. You know, they have their pre-tribulation, they need a new doctrine. They're hardcore Zionists, they need a new doctrine. They're dispensational, they need a new doctrine. And if you take dispensationalism and cast it out the window, cast it in the garbage, that would fix a lot of these churches' problems. But that's a good thing that we're able to stand here and we're able to say, hey, we don't need new doctrine in 2017. Because a lot of these independent fundamental Baptist churches can't say that. What we don't need new in 2017 is we don't need new doctrine. And these churches today are becoming just like the world. The beliefs and the opinions of this world and the philosophies of this world are like shifting sand. They're changing constantly. You can't even keep up with the new beliefs. And that's exactly how all these other churches are today. That's exactly how all the statements of faith of all these Baptist churches are today. They're changing their doctrine constantly. You know why? Because they're not settled and not founded upon the solid rock, upon the Bible. Their beliefs aren't based upon the Bible because it's never changing. The Bible's doctrines aren't changing. Then why are all these churches' doctrines changing? Because they're not biblical. Turn to Ephesians chapter number 4, verse number 14. What you don't need new in 2017 is you don't need new doctrine. Ephesians chapter number 4, verse number 14, it says, that we henceforth be no more children, tossed to and fro and carried about with every wind of doctrine by the sleight of men and cunning craftiness, whereby they lie in wait to deceive. So if all these people's doctrine, all these churches' doctrines are changing constantly, and they're just being tossed to and fro, you know what they're like? The Bible says they're like children. They're easily deceived. Children are very easy to deceive. Not only that, they're like the philosophers of Acts chapter number 17. They're just dying to hear some new thing. They just go from one thing to another thing to another thing. And you know a person that's very easy to deceive is a person that has a false belief. Because there's so many holes in their argument. So, you know, a person that has, you know, that's pre-tribulation, that's Zionist, that's dispensational, it's very hard for them to defend their position, especially when attacked by the truth. But if you have some other perverted, you know, religion that has maybe one thing right, they can come to the door of a person that has the right salvation, that is saved, that is a Baptist, and they can argue that point, and they can defeat that person in an argument in those topics. Because a person with a false belief is very easy to defeat in an argument. And it's very easy, and you know a person that's easily deceived also, not only that, a person that's very easily deceived is a person that holds a false belief. Because their position just doesn't hold water. Because it's very easy to attack their position and to defeat their position. Turn to 1 Corinthians chapter number 15. Not only should you not change your doctrine in 2017, you should learn your doctrine better. You should grow in the doctrine that you already have. You don't need to add new doctrine. You don't need to just change your doctrine all the time. That's not something that you need new in 2017. You need to get the right doctrine and then you need to keep the right doctrine. But not only that, you need to grow and you need to abound in the right doctrine. You need to continually learn because a person, here's the thing too, not only is a person that is wrong or has a false belief easy to deceive, a person that doesn't know what they believe about a subject. So you might just be repeating, hey, I know that it's post-trib and I know that it's pre-rat, but you may not know how to defend that position. You may not know why you believe that. That doesn't matter. I mean, obviously you're right. It's not going to make you wrong. Even if somebody comes to you with pre-tribulation belief and they're able to defend their position better than you are, that doesn't make them right. But it does make you very easily deceived if you don't know. The reason why a child is very easily deceived is because they're ignorant. It's because they don't know certain answers to questions and they're just tossed to and fro. Well, a Christian could be the same way. You could be taught the right belief. And you could say, hey, I'm post-trib pre-wrath. But you may not have any idea how to defend that. And you would be easily deceived. 2 Timothy 1:13 says this. Hold fast the form of sound words. Just like, you know, the Bible talks about sound doctrine. Hold fast the form of sound words which thou hast heard of me in faith and love which is in Christ Jesus. Look there in 1 Corinthians chapter number 15. Look at verse number 58. He says, therefore, my beloved brethren, be steadfast, unmovable, always abounding in the work of the Lord. For as much as ye know that your labor is not in vain in the Lord. So notice again, we see the word steadfast, right? The word steadfast, you know, it's spelled differently when we spell it today. It's S-T-E-A-D-F-A-S-T. That's because the word stead there, that first, that prefix part of that word, that is talking about being steady. That's the first part of the word, steady. That's why we spell it with E-A-D, just like how we spell steady now. The last part means fast, as in fasten. Just like when Jesus said, hold fast. You know, hold tight. This is talking about fastening something or tightening something. So when he says steadfast, he's saying be steady and be fastened. He's saying stay in the, you know, stay where you're at now. He's not talking about changing something, right? And then he says this, steadfast, and he says, and then he talks about abounding. He says steadfast. He defines steadfast for you as well. He says unmovable. And then he says always abounding in the work of the Lord. Abounding is growing. It's learning more. So you need to be steadfast where you're at, but abounding at the same time. That's, you know, and somebody can say, well, that doesn't make sense to me. It's because, you know, you're not changing something as in something new. It's the same thing that you have now. You're steadfast. It's like if you think about it as maybe like an analogy like this. You know, you're on the same mountain or you're on the same rock, but you're just abounding up that same rock. You're steadfast as in you're not leaving that rock. You're immovable or unmovable as in you're not leaving that rock. You're not changing all these new things. You're abounding in what you already have. Look at 2 Peter chapter number 3. You don't have to turn there. I'll read it to you again. But as I said before, I pointed out this, how it talks about being steadfast. 2 Peter chapter number 3, verse number 17. Ye therefore, beloved, seeing ye know these things before, beware lest ye also, being led away with the error of the wicked, fall from your own steadfastness. So again, we see that. And then watch this. Just like it said, abounding right after that before. But grow in grace and in the knowledge of our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ. So we're steadfast upon the rock of Jesus. We're steadfast, we're unmovable upon the rock of Jesus. That's not changing. But we're growing in knowledge of Jesus. We're growing in knowledge of the doctrines that we already hold. We're not just getting new doctrine all the time. We're not just changing all of our statement, you know, our statement of faith, every article of our belief. No, we keep the same articles. Once we find the truth, we hold fast. But we abound in that doctrine. We grow in that doctrine. We learn more about that doctrine. We continue in the same doctrine. Now get two things in your hand. Get Acts chapter number 11, verse number 26. And then get 1 Peter chapter number 4. So Acts chapter number 11, verse number 26. And then in your right hand, excuse me, get 1 Peter chapter number 4. Look at Acts chapter number 11, verse number 26 first. This is the first time the word Christian is used. And when he had found him, he brought him unto Antioch. And it came to pass that a whole year they assembled themselves with the church and taught much people. And watch this statement. And the disciples were called Christians first in Antioch. Now look at 1 Peter chapter number 4, and also while we turn there, keep in mind that they didn't call themselves Christians. It just says they were it says the disciples were first called Christians in Antioch. As in the Christians, the disciples weren't calling themselves Christians. Other people were calling them Christians. It was like as a derogatory term. They're mocking them. They're saying you're Christian. But you know what? We embrace that obviously because us as Christians, we're still called Christians today, and we even refer to ourselves as Christians. Look at 1 Peter chapter number 4. Look at verse number 14. Peter speaking says, if ye be reproached for the name of Christ, happy are ye, for the Spirit of glory and of God resteth upon you. On their part he is evil spoken of, but on your part he is glorified. Notice that. If he's talking about being reproached for Christ, he says on their part he is evil spoken of, but on your part he is glorified. And he says, verse 15, but let none of you suffer as a murderer, or as a thief, or as an evildoer, or as a busybody in other men's matters. Yet if any man suffer as a Christian, let him not be ashamed, but let him glorify God on this behalf. So notice he talks about reproach. Just a minute ago we saw that those in the book of Acts were referring to the disciples as Christians. It's mockery. And then here he talks about if any man suffer as a Christian, right after he just got done saying about, you know, receiving reproach, receiving mockery. He says, if any man suffer as a Christian, and we can tell by the way that that's worded by Peter that he's embracing the term. He says, yet if any man suffer as a Christian, let him not be ashamed, but let him glorify God on this behalf. So he's saying, I'm not ashamed of being called a Christian. I have no problem with that at all. And the same thing goes for today. And the third thing that we don't need new, and the third thing that we don't need to change is we don't need to change our name. And I'm not only talking about being called a Christian. I'm not ashamed at all to be called a Christian. But I'm also not ashamed of being called a Baptist. See, no one has a problem with being called a Christian today. But there's a lot of people that have a problem with being called a Baptist. I think the name Baptist is just fine. And if you believe what I've preached so far and you agreed with what I say, if you thought to yourself, hey, you know, I agreed with your last point. I agreed, hey, we shouldn't get new doctrine. And doctrine's important. But then you say to me, well, I don't really know about this point. I don't really know about how important it is really to call yourself, you know, a Baptist or not. But here's the thing. The reason why I want to call myself a Baptist, the reason why it's important to make sure that we have a name and we have a title, is because these names and these titles mean something. They stand for something. And I, just like I'm not ashamed to be called a Christian, because I'm following Christ, because I believe in Christ, right? I believe all the fundamentals of what the Christians in the Bible believe. I believe all the fundamentals that Baptists believe. I believe the only real Christian is a Baptist, as far as a Bible believer, as far as all these other false denominations preach a false gospel. I'm not ashamed at all to be called a Baptist. I'm not ashamed at all to be called an independent fundamental Baptist. You know, the reason why, you know, it used to be that just all the real Christians were just called Christians. And you know what happens? if false teachings creep in, and then people want to, you know, the real Christians want to separate themselves from all the false Christians. So they change their name or they make it longer. We should change our name. They make their name longer, right? They don't stop saying, hey, I'm a Christian, but they add something to it. They add something to it. They don't change the fact that I'm a Christian. And it used to be in this country that Baptists were the real Bible believers. And all you had to say was, hey, I was a Baptist. And they knew that you believed the fundamentals of the faith. They knew you believed in the deity of Christ. They knew you believed, you know, in the authority of the scriptures and that it was infallible and that we had God's word preserved unto us today. That you believed in salvation by grace through faith alone. That we believed in believers' baptism only and that it's only by immersion. But now you have all these weirdo, whacked out Baptists, and I'm not just a Baptist, I'm an independent fundamental Baptist. I'm not going to change my name, I'm just going to make my name longer. And I want to do that to separate myself from the weirdos, to separate myself from the people that are teaching false doctrine. And you know all the people that want to complain about, hey, what's the problem of being a Baptist? You know, why do you have this struggle about, you know, about making sure you keep this name? Why can't you just be called, you know, the church in Phoenix or the church in Tempe? Why do you want to do that? Because I want to separate myself from people like you. The people that want to say that all the time are the people I'm trying to separate myself from. You know, and maybe there are a lot of these Baptists that are saved believers and they bought into this idea. Well, I don't want to separate myself. I don't want to really put myself in any category. I just want to be called, you know, the church in Cincinnati or the church in wherever. I just want to be called that. You're still putting yourself in a category. Because when I look at you, I look at you the same as I look at the Vineyard. And when I look at you at church in Cincinnati or church in Tempe or church in Phoenix, I look at you like I look at Cornerstone. Or I look at you like you're still putting yourself in a category. And they're liars. They know that they're doing that. That's what they want to do. They want to be like all these other watered down churches. And it's because they, you know, excuse me. It's because they have no problem at all with being watered down. Because when you come into the church, it's not like, oh, it's just the name. When you come into the church, the preaching is just like the name. Because you know what names do? They reflect the church. Like here, we're independent, we're fundamental Baptists. With that, you know, a lot of people know, hey, that means hard preaching. So when they come in, they're going to expect hard preaching. When you see somebody's name, hey, you know, Bible Church or the church in Cincinnati or whatever. You know what you can expect when you walk in that church? It's not like, oh, everybody's welcome here. That's the only thing. That's not all that it is. You know what you can expect when you walk into that church? Very vague preaching because the name's vague. Very unclear and speech that's not plain like the Bible says. That's what you can expect when you go into a church like that. You know what you can expect when you look at a statement of faith from people like that? If they have a very unclear name, an unclear statement of faith, where they don't want to tell you what they believe. That's why they changed their name. Don't let them try to tell you, hey, it's just because, you know, we just want to be accepting. We don't want to, you know, be branded. You want to be branded. You want to be put in the category with Vineyard. That's what you want. You want to be, to be looked at like you're real vague and real unclear. That's the whole purpose of why you did that in the first place. You know, something new that we don't need in 2017 is we don't need a new name. We're Baptists. Look at 1 Thessalonians chapter number 2. Oh man, I'm dying up here. 1 Thessalonians chapter number 2. 1 Thessalonians chapter number 2, verse number 11. The Bible says, whoops, I'm in 2 Thessalonians. I'm going to say that's not right. I might change my Bible. 1 Thessalonians chapter number 2, verse number 11, it says, as ye now, as ye know how we exhorted and comforted and charged every one of you, as a father doth his children, that ye would walk worthy of God who hath called you unto his kingdom and glory. Verse number 13, for this cause also thank we God without ceasing, because when ye received the word of God which ye heard of us, ye received it not as the word of men, but as it is in truth the word of God. And then watch what he says next. Which effectually worketh also in you that believe. And my last point, the fourth point, and the fourth thing that we don't need to change in 2017, and the fourth thing that we don't need new in 2017, is we don't need a Bible. And what the things that I'm picking out right now are things that people are actually changing, and things that people are actually getting new every single year. Notice what he says, though, to those in Thessalonica here. In 1 Thessalonians chapter number 2, he says in verse number 13, he says, when you receive the word of God, so this is initially, this is right when they first heard the Bible, right when they first heard the words of God. When you receive the word of God, which ye heard of us, ye received it not as the word of men, but as it is in truth the word of God. Then he says this, which effectually worketh also in you that believe. So notice they're holding fast to the word of God. They're holding fast to the truth. They didn't only receive it, right? They didn't only start off on the King James Bible. They continued on the King James Bible. They continued on the same things that we believe today. The same words that they read at that time. Obviously, it wasn't the version of the King James Bible. It wasn't in English, but it was the same exact words. It was the same exact words in a different language, because God promised to preserve His Word unto all generations. Old Testament, New Testament, Jesus Christ said, heaven and earth shall pass away, but my words shall not pass away. The psalmist David said in Psalms chapter number 12, verse number 6, he said, for the words of the Lord are pure words, as silver tried in the furnace of fire, purified seven times. He said, thou shalt keep them, O Lord. Thou shalt preserve them from this generation and forever. People say, yeah, the words are preserved. There's just little changes, little differences here and there. No, you missed the point of the verse. He said, for the words of the Lord are pure words. So do you know what words are preserved? Pure words. So if you have two different Bibles and they both say two different things, if that's all that came to us today, if the only thing that we had was two versions of the Bible, if that's all that we had, you know what I know? One's pure and one's not. That's what I know. Because God was very clear. He said, my words are pure, right? And then he said, and I'm going to preserve those words, the pure words. So if they say two different things, one's wrong and one's right. Just like if we have 50 versions, one's right and 49 are wrong. Just like another gospel, just like another Jesus, another spirit, one's right, the grace of Christ, and every other gospel's wrong. Every other gospel is wrong. There's only one truth, my friend. 2 + 2 = 4. It doesn't equal 5, 6, 7, and 8. There's one truth, and that's it, period. And God preserved those words unto us today, and we don't need a new Bible. And there's a lot of people that are subscribed to the, you know, they have this mentality where they just need the new Bible to come out. They just need this, you know, they need to get the best translation or the better translation. And a lot of, you know, people have it in their mind like, saved people can't do that. Saved people, you know, will use different versions. Saved people. I believe that if you pin a saved person down, they would admit, yeah, you know, the King James Bible is the best version for sure. They would at least say that. I believe that for sure. I believe they know in their heart that the Holy Spirit guides them, and then when they hear the voice of the shepherd, they know that that's the voice. But they don't have to follow the voice of the shepherd. We still have free will. God doesn't force you what Bible to read. God doesn't make you, you know, sit down and read the King James Bible. If the King James Bible, which it is offensive and tans your hide, and you're living in sin, you're not going to want to read the King James Bible. You would much rather read the NIV. And that's why a lot of saved believers, a lot of saved Christians, don't read the King James Bible today. People have this idea what you have to read the King James Bible or you're saved. That's not true. Now, I believe that they know for a fact that the King James Bible in their heart is right. Just like you can live in sin. God doesn't force you to live a clean life. God doesn't force you to walk after the Spirit. You have the choice. You can either, you know, walk in true doctrine, walk in right doctrine, read the right Bible, or you can walk in sin, believe false things, choose not to believe what the truth is. People don't always have to tell you what's in their heart. People can be thinking to themselves like, hey, I know that that's right. I know that the King James Bible has power and authority. I know that that's the voice of the shepherd. I just choose not to believe it. I just choose not to believe it, but not to follow it. I just choose not to read that particular version. And that's something that we don't need new. All these independent fundamental Baptists are changing their versions left and right. John L. Rice used the ASV when he died. Tons of, you know, a super, super popular independent fundamental Baptist, John L. Rice. Curtis Hudson used the other versions for years. We don't need to be like them. We don't need to be like Cornerstone and change our name to Baptist. We don't need to be like, you know, Vineyard or change our name from Baptist. We don't need to be like the Vineyard Church. Change our name. You know, we need to stay Baptist. And not only do we need to stay Baptist, we need to stay independent fundamental Baptist. And that means we're King James only. That means we're not changing the, you know, what Bible that we read or what Bible that we use. That's something new. That's not something new that we need in 2017. Hey, you need new things. You're not a perfect Christian. You need to add things to your Christian life. You need to do new things, you know, in your Christian life in 2017. But you know what you also need? You need to hold fast things that you already had in 2017. And this applies to your whole life. You may keep serving God to some extent, but you may stop doing certain things in 15 years that you were doing today. You need to hold fast in 2017. And you really just need to hold fast till Jesus comes. Like he said, that which you already have, hold fast, you know, till I come. You need to hold fast. Number one, you need to hold fast. Let me look at my point number one was, I do this every once in a while. We need to hold fast to the same gospel. We need to make sure that we're not getting a new gospel. Number two, we need to hold fast to our doctrine. We need to keep the same doctrine. We don't need new doctrine. We don't need to just change our doctrine all the time. We're right. We don't need to change our doctrine. Number three, we don't need a new name. We're Baptists. We're independent fundamental Baptists. We don't need a new name. We're Christians. We don't need a new name. Number four, and turn to 1 Thessalonians chapter number 5, verse number 21, is that we don't need a new Bible. We need to keep the same Bible in 2017. I'll read you from Titus chapter number 1, verse number 9. He says, holding fast the faithful word as he hath been taught, that he may be able by sound doctrine both to exhort and to convince the gainsayers. So notice he says, holding fast the faithful word. We need to hold fast to the faithful word of the King James Bible. It's just like in Jeremiah 2, where God says, you know, my people have changed their glory, talking about himself, for that which doth not profit. That's what a lot of Christians are doing nowadays. They're changing their glory of the King James Bible for that which doesn't profit, like this trash ESV, like the NIV, like, you know, the New American Standard Bible. That's what they're doing. They're changing it for that which doth not profit. Look at 1 Thessalonians chapter number 5, verse number 21, and we'll end here. 1 Thessalonians chapter number 5, verse number 21, he says, prove all things, hold fast that which is good. So he says, prove all things, hold fast that which is good. The title of the sermon is Hold Fast in 2017. Once you find out that something's good, once you find out that something's right, once you find out you prove, that means you test it, and you know, hey, this is the truth. Once you know, hey, I got the right gospel, I know I'm saved, you don't need a new gospel. Once you find the right doctrine, once you get the right doctrine, and you know that that's right, you've proved it, you need to hold that fast. Once you find out, hey, the Baptists are the only one that's right, they've been saying this for a long time, that is true. You know what you need to do? You need to stay in a Baptist church. You need to not change your name from Baptist. That's what you need to do. And then once you get the right Bible, once you hear the King James Bible and you hear the authority and the power that comes forth from the Bible, when you read John 3:16 and there's no other version that sounds like it, when you read the rest of the Bible and it just none of the other versions have near the quite that same power, you need to hold fast to the King James Bible, because there are a lot of people that are changing these things. There are a lot of saved believers that are, you know, trading in and that are getting something new that's not good, that they have improved, that's not right. So not only do you, Christian, need to add something new to your life in 2017 that's good, you need to also hold fast to that which you already have in 2017, and keep doing the things that you were already doing that was right, and not lose sight of the good things that you already have now, but hold fast in 2017. Let's pray. Heavenly Father God, we thank you for this opportunity to come here and meet, dear Lord God. We thank you, dear Lord, for your word, and that it is powerful, dear Lord God, and that it is the truth, and that we can prove it, and we know it's good, and help us just to hold fast, dear Lord God. Help us to be steadfast, and help us to be unmovable, dear Lord God, and also help us to abound. Help us to abound in the right doctrine, dear Lord God, and help us to abound in our spiritual walk with you, dear Lord. And help, we do also pray, dear Lord God, and ask that 2017 would be a greater year, and we would serve you better in 2017 than we did in 2016. And we thank you, and we ask you to bless the rest of the day today, dear Lord God, and bless the services. And in Jesus Christ's name, amen.